Mass transportation in Kansas City has faced many changes since Nehemiah Holmes started the first horse-drawn railroad system in 1869. Little did Holmes know that more than 100 years later, his venture would be transformed into a sleek, fast-moving, and modern transit system now called the Kansas City Area Transportation Authority. The original Kansas City and Westport Horse Railway Company has been obscured by years of metropolitan growth, funding problems, and other obstacles. In spite of the problems, the company evolved throughout the years to become a responsible community servant that now offers everyone a future in transportation without discrimination. But it wasn't always that way. Prior to the 1930s, blacks' participation in transportation was limited to ridership only. The move to integrate blacks into the workforce began in the 1930s and 40s when the company name was the Kansas City Public Service Company. But even then, blacks were only allowed to work domestic jobs like washing and waxing buses and occasionally driving them to a holding station. Opportunities in non-domestic jobs were unattainable until the late 1950s. By then, the civil rights movement challenged the public consciousness. As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. dramatically expressed it, "I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal." This video is dedicated to past and present employees who endured the racial injustice of that time and carried the burden to light a path for generations to come.
I started 1940, March the 14th. March the 14th would be 50 years.
I worked in 1941 until 1978. 37 and a half years.
I was a young guy at 14 years old when I started. I put my age up to 18 so I could get the job. I walked from 18th and Walnut out there to see about it. And I got hired May the 6th, 43.
I started bus company July 17th of 1945. I've been there 44 years.
It was in 1960, I'm sure, but in the months of maybe January or February, because we went in training Thanksgiving in the middle of March. And coincidentally, we got our badge on my birthday, May the 3rd, 1960.
Always reminded of their position, black workers held their tongues if they wanted to continue to feed their families. However, some blacks were willing to accept the challenge and risk of speaking out.
Well, at that time, in 1941, your situation was different than it is in 1990, because it was said that you know your place. And that always bothered me. Where was my place? If I was qualified, if I had the same qualifications as that other man had, it seemed like that I should be qualified like that other person. But they always put you in a category that you are all alike. And I never believed that, because I know that I worked hard, and I think that I earned what I was after. I had a aim in life.
It really don't make you feel good. It hurts. But you learn to live with it. You can't up and hit somebody in the head and think you're going to come back to work the next day. So you got to kind of play it cool. Just hope it wears off. A lot of the old timers, it wore off. And some of them it didn't, on both sides. In other words, I guess it's just something that you have to learn to live with.
They was kind of split up. It was kind of a little nagging between them, a Catholic bunch, and Masons. They didn't get along, but I wasn't in either one, so it didn't bother me. That was them. See, so I just stayed out of the reach of both of them. And that's the way I got along.
I really don't think I was coming until I was made an instructor. Then I I was more comfortable because I could mingle more with the management and union, and, you know, even though I'd driven bus, you know, but I felt that's when I began to feel comfortable because I felt like I could express myself and I was wide open. You know, being a Jackie Robinson and being one of the pioneers, that was a lot of time I would open my mouth and said things that, you know, but my mother, along with the others, told me, Harris, whatever you do, hold your peace.
During this era in America, blacks were still considered second-class citizens. Although many were highly skilled, they were not provided equal employment opportunities.
I was hurt because I knew that I was qualified to do more than mopping a floor or clean the side of a bus, and yet they wouldn't give me that chance. See, I studied electronics, I studied air conditioning, and I had always been mechanically and electrically inclined, but they wouldn't give me that job. Though they would hire a young man off the farm or out of a drugstore, one man was hired as he had been a salad maker. And I talked to him because I quizzed him because I figured that I watched him and I knew that he didn't exactly know his job. And he was learning it on the job. And I knew that I could do it. And I found out he was a salad maker. Well, how could you be a mechanic and you had just previously been a salad maker?
Brooks and them whispered to me and told me, said, you know, Bob Powell makes 3 cents more now than y'all do, making 42. Said he made 45. What kind of stuff is this? So caught Mr. Buff. Say, Mr. Buff, what's here? Bob makes 3 cents more now. I said, yep. I said, why? He said, it takes more for a white man to live than do color. Yes, sir. He gave me my answer. I walked on away. You know, wasn't no more you could say. He told you right to your face.
The public unwillingness to accept change forced black employees to endure insults and harassment.
But on my very first week, all the five operators, black operators, was on the Prospect Line. And this was on a Sunday. One of the our first turnaround was then was at 48th and Prospect. 49th or 48th and Prospect. And the longest route was 75th and Prospect, where Fairyland. And we work started out, I suppose, on a weekend, and then Sunday we all began our run. Or maybe 2 or 3 days thereafter, or before. But nevertheless, we was all on Prospect. Because Prospect was one of the hottest lines then. And they were individuals just waiting for operators. Now, the lowest one on the seniority poll was glad that we was accepted. Whether we was black or white, they was glad because they got a chance to move. So we all ended up on Prospect, which was one of the hottest lines. That Sunday, I pulled up. I don't remember the exact time. I know it was nice. It was a nice day. And I remember the exact time, but my first pull up, or at the stop, operator got on the bus, and I remember his face. I didn't remember his name. He was an old-time operator. And he said, I thought I'd just come and ride with you, see how the people going to accept it. Coincidentally, the very first stop, we pulled up at Brush Creek and Prospect, the white passenger lady got ready to step on the bus, and first thing she said, I'm not riding with no black operator. To me, that was a bit harassment. And then I got to thinking, now, you got to hold your peace. And I said, okay, thank you, and drove off. So the white old-time operator asked me a question, said, Harris, didn't that kind of upset you? I said, well, in a way, I said, but she'll be standing out there for another hour because it's four right behind me.
The Kansas City Public Service Company began the process of eliminating employment barriers for blacks. When the Kansas City Area Transportation Authority acquired the company, they continued the work of providing equal employment opportunities for everyone.
There is no comparison with today. There's none. Because today, you go in with your qualifications. You don't go in for color. You see, today, you have blacks, you have Mexicans, you have all nationalities working for the transit, the ATA today, where you didn't have that, and they have the great opportunities today because your qualifications take over, not your color. And see, there's no comparison with today's ATA.
It is an equal opportunity now, and I think that the company goes along with the equal opportunity, and blacks, there's no limit to the height that they can go. We've got black road supervisors, we've got black clerks, typists, we've got black people all upstairs, mixed, and they work pretty good together, I'd say. It's not like it used to be. You take 40 years ago, the only black in the office would be the janitor. Maybe come down to load up some heavy machinery or a desk or something on a truck. That's about the only way you got in there.
They don't have to do the type of work we had to do. So we, what do some of these guys do now? They got helpers. I used to do the job by myself. Like I used to know park buses on Saturday nights and not work weekends. I did the whole thing by myself.
I believe that was more so discrimination within individuals and within than it was the company. Because we was pushed and they stood behind us. They knew that we was going to hide. And I can say then that the superintendent, along with the white instructors and Mr. Jensen and the people at the organization, they stood behind us. They stood behind it. And they told us any incident that we might feel like that we've been discriminated against, report it. Some of them we did, some of them we didn't.
Throughout history, there are people unknowingly thrust into roles destined to impact generations to come. We call them pioneers.
I was trying to change it after I got in there. And I think that I did make a little change. Because, you know, the one thing that I want these young men to know now that are coming into the transit company, the ATA, that somebody back there helped them get where they are today. Because you don't just walk in off the street and get hired today. You have to be qualified today. Now, see, back there years ago, you just needed a job and somebody recommended it and you went down and got hired. But today, you have to be qualified. And I think that's wonderful in the transit company.
Being hired as one of the first blacks, that was a stepping stone to step forward. And I think it opened up a lot of eyes. That if you give us the opportunity to drive one, we could prove that we could drive a bus. Now, as far as the community, I was already known throughout the community being the church leader, being the director of choirs and all of that. Now, I can't say I was known throughout the metropolitan area, but within the vicinity of, you know, of the area. But it was a big thing then that, you know, you could drive down the street, and I don't really think that a lot of individuals didn't know that horn was on the bus that we started driving. Because we see one of our friends, we was glad to let them know that we was driving the bus. And there was a lot who would stand back and wait on one of the black operators. And I had to ride on Prospect, and I can remember well when the bus ahead of me carried 10 and I carried standing low.
Whenever I catch a young guy coming on, I kind of, if he holds still long enough, I'll take him under my wings, break him in the best I knew how. Teach them the ropes around, the do's and the don'ts, and introduce them to the other blacks, whites as well. And I'm just kind of proud of being a black that have come this far.
Black pioneers have been an integral part of transit history in Kansas City and play important roles in the present success of the ATA. Today, 47% of the KCATA's employees are minority, holding the spectrum of positions from Class A mechanics to operators, to secretaries, to high-level management. Transit operations in Kansas City have come a long way, but the best is yet to come.
So improvement, we still got a long ways to go. But there are, that's some improvement.
Oh, they got great opportunities if they take advantage of it.
I'm telling you, couldn't work for a better place. Bus company over there, I couldn't.
That's a great feeling, and I feel like we've come a long ways. Like I said, we're in everything now.
We have blacks and we have minorities. We have in positions now that I never dreamed of, and that's just been a short period of time. So I think if they continue on the road that they're on today, that there's no telling how far that they'll go.